In this lecture segment, we want to start talking about the necessary raw materials we'll need to do software development in this course. Specifically, we're talking about the Java language itself and the jGRASP IDE. Okay, let's get started. If you step back and think about it, I think you'll probably agree that many real-world areas of skill typically require two main things: raw materials and some sort of tools with which to manipulate those materials. Consider baking for an example. Bakers typically use ingredients such as flour, sugar, and baking powder, and tools such as a good hot oven, a mixer, baking sheets, and so forth. A carpenter might use tools such as a table saw, hammers, drills, and a level to work with raw materials such as lumber, nails, wood screws, and so forth. Now, I'm not meaning to compare software to baking or carpentry, but as it turns out, software isn't much different in this regard. So extending this idea to software development, whenever we want to do development in any programming language, we typically need the following two key things: the software language itself, and some development environment to write, compile, and execute some new programs that we might create. Back in days past, of course, software would often be written at a command line in some sort of text editor, but nowadays a modern development environment is really the way you want to go. Luckily for us in this course, both the Java language and the jGRASP IDE are both free downloads and are easily installed. Since you're already paying a bunch of money to attend this course and purchase the textbook, perhaps, you really can't beat that price, can you? So next, let's talk a little bit about the different versions of Java that are available and make sure we're clear on what's what. Over the years, Java has been through many, many version and release updates. For the really motivated or the really curious, you can take a look in Wikipedia at this URL for the full history of Java releases and what features were added over time. This link is also found in this week's lecture materials. You will need to download and install a Java version for this course. However, you don't necessarily need the latest and greatest version. We'll be focusing on long-established fundamental concepts, nothing that will be dependent upon latest and greatest features. For example, the somewhat earlier Java 8 JDK is also more than sufficient for our purposes. In fact, I used that release for several years when I didn't have a current 64-bit OS to run the latest releases. I've given up trying to keep this slide updated with the latest Java version details. So, please see either this semester's welcome letter or the syllabus for the current versions. While many software products are purchased and licensed, many modern-day software languages or tools are free downloads. And fortunately for us, this includes Java. Java is a free download from Oracle, and here's the URL where you can find it. This should be the same URL that's also given in your syllabus, and that was given in the welcome letter sent out twice before the semester. I hope that most, if not all of you, have already done this installation. It's just a one-time install, and then it will just line the background for us, waiting to be used. In other words, we don't invoke it over and over again, like many apps you might be used to. You need to be aware of the main two variants of Java and the differences between them. As indicated here, the main two variants pertinent to us are the Java JDK and the Java JRE. Let's take a look at the differences between these two. So what is the difference? The Java Runtime Environment, or JRE, gives you everything that you need to run Java-enabled applications on your system. It's often referred to as the Java Runtime. Most modern computers or browsers that build themselves as Java-enabled already come with the JRE pre-installed, so in many cases, users don't even have to concern themselves with this. However, the JRE by itself isn't enough to let us develop new Java applications. For that purpose, we need the Java Development Kit, or JDK. The JDK is an even larger bundle of software that lets us develop new Java applications. It consists of the Java language itself, various class library extensions, and the Java compiler, all of which we'll discuss in upcoming lectures. So when you're looking to download Java, be sure that you select the JDK and not the JRE. In fact, the JDK encompasses the JRE, but also adds so much more. So how do we know that this is what we need? Well, the answer is spelled out for us right on the Oracle download site. Which Java package do I need? for software developers, the JDK. And as we just said, it includes a complete JRE plus tools for developing, debugging, and monitoring Java applications. Exactly what we just said, but now straight from the Oracle horse's mouth.
To emphasize the point that we just made, note how this diagram shows that the JRE is a small subset of the JDK. The JDK contains the JRE plus so much more. Technically, installation of the JDK is purely optional on your part. If you have any other courses on campus and don't mind working within the confines of the lab hours, you'll find that the Java JDK should be pre-installed and available for student use in the campus CS computer lab, as noted in the syllabus. However, all that is obviously a moot point for this semester for fully remote online instruction. But the whole point of taking an online course is to be able to work in your own environment and on your own schedule. So when you are downloading the Java JDK for installation, look for a download button similar to the one shown in the screenshot on the right. Make sure it's indeed the JDK that you are downloading, not the JRE.
We just covered the first raw material of software development, the programming language itself, or in our case, the Java JDK. So now let's shift our attention to the other side, to the tools needed to develop with that language. In modern day software development, we typically like to work with a programming language using an integrated development environment, or an IDE. An IDE is a cleanly, tightly integrated set of software development tools which can all be invoked underneath one common multi-paned window or application framework. IDEs often have lots of shiny bells and whistles or neat capabilities, but typically as software developers, we're going to be interested in three core capabilities: editing code, compiling code, and debugging code. An IDE will provide for some sort of editor capability, which allows us to write and maintain code written in Java or any other language. Once code is written, an IDE will provide some sort of easy-to-use interface to an underlying compiler so that we can turn our program into binary ones and zeros for execution. Finally, one of the nicest capabilities of an IDE is often its debugger, which you can think of as a code execution simulator, which allows us to execute our program line by line to find any errors. However, the name debugger is somewhat of a misnomer because we can't run a debugger to find our logic bugs until we first found and removed all of the syntax bugs which prevent our code from compiling cleanly and executing. Here's a picture showing what our jGRASP IDE main window is going to look like. You've probably seen this type of application before. It's a multi-paned window with several resizable windows and a main menu of options at the top. The largest window, at upper right, is the editor window, which is where we will write all our code. Below it, in the lower right, is the messages window. Depending on what we're doing at the moment, this is where we'll see either compiler output messages or else program data outputs. The window at the left is the file browser. We can select a working directory using the drop-down menu at the top, and then we'll see its contents as a directory and file structure in the main body of this window. Hopefully this type of top-level windowing structure is not entirely unfamiliar to you. So why are we using jGRASP in this class as opposed to other alternatives such as Eclipse, NetBeans, BlueJ, or other IDEs? Well, obviously one reason is that it's a free download, although that's no different from the others. You can find and download jGRASP from the indicated URL. What I like about jGRASP, and the main reason I ask that you use it for this class, is that it's easy to use, reasonably well-featured, but not excessively so. One thing I find about software tools with lots of shiny bells and whistles is that it can be easy to go off into the weeds and get wrapped up in details which aren't the most important task at hand. I like jGRASP because it's simple, but not too much so. It keeps the focus of our efforts on the language, where it should be, and not on using the tool. I also like jGRASP because it makes our lives simpler, but it doesn't try to do too much of the work for us. Other more powerful tools will sometimes try to automatically do too much of the work for us, such as typing completion or context-aware editors which try to anticipate the next code we're trying to write. If you're learning a language in this class, I want you to have the experience and practice of doing all those things for yourself. Later on, once you've learned Java well and are writing code for yourself, or perhaps someday writing code for a living, by all means use a more capable professional strength tool. But here, where we're trying to learn the language, let's keep the focus of our attention on Java and not on the tool, where it belongs. Regarding performing the installations themselves, we're very fortunate here in that both installations are very straightforward and very reliable. I've done these installs myself numerous times and have had pretty much zero issues with them. So what you want to do first is to download both of the install executables, the Java JDK and jGRASP, using the URLs on the prior slides. Make sure that you select the right executable, in other words, Windows, Apple, Linux, or so forth. As in doing most any software installs, it's probably best to do this in an account that has admin privileges. The only thing you should be aware of is that you must do the Java install before jGRASP, because jGRASP needs to know where Java is. To perform the installs, it's really just as simple as double-clicking on each executable and letting it run to completion. If you accept the default settings and install locations, you should be just fine. You might want to test your jGRASP install by simply starting up the application, but in the next lecture segment, we'll go through a step-by-step process of writing a simple Java program which will test out both of these installations. Okay, that's it for this lecture. Please continue on with the next lecture module, which should be Hello World.